The local film industry has seen an increase in expansion with more filmmakers now more than ever. I'm Marcus Esparza, and I have more on that coming up.
New local unique. My TV 53 News at 8 starts right now.
Good evening and welcome to the San Joaquin Valley's only 8 p.m. news. I'm Valentina Saldana. My TV 53's Marcus Esparza is covering our top story tonight, and he joins us with more. Marcus?
With one particular filmmaker gaining traction in the local film industry, he is now working on his next project.
See, that's the same website of that show you're so obsessed with. You know, I think you gotta stop watching these horror shows and get out of the house some. I'm talking today? I gotta get you another appointment with Dr. Witherspoon and get your meds straightened out. I'm going to call Dr. Witherspoon.
With years in the industry, Michael has a variety of films he has produced and directed. With his classic horror film style, he is sure to intrigue fans of the genre. From his first film, Night of the Sea Monkey, 2013, to his most recent, which was a creature feature full-length film called Daisy, he is amongst many of the great indie filmmakers in the Central Valley.
For my first short film, I won several awards. That was Night of the Sea Monkey. And then the following year, I won Best Director for Lampfeed. A couple years after that, I did a movie called Jack Incarnate that won some awards. And currently, Daisy, the film I premiered recently, is on the circuit. So fingers crossed, we'll see what we can rack up this season.
Completion of Michael's next film is set for the end of this month and is planned to release to world premiere festivals in early summer. I'm Marcus Esparza reporting for MyTV 53 News at 8.
Thanks, Marcus. Turning to your crime report, at 11:40 p.m. last Wednesday, Madera police officers noticed Gonzalo de Jesus acting erratically, swinging a makeshift metal weapon near the intersection of Gateway Drive and 4th Street. De Jesus did not comply when he was told to drop the weapon. When the officers approached De Jesus, he reared back with the metal object over his head, preparing to assault the officers. De Jesus began to walk away after confronting officers with the weapon. Due to the obvious risk De Jesus posed to the community, officers followed De Jesus on foot and provided commands to de-escalate the situation by having De Jesus drop the weapon. De Jesus turned and swung the weapon toward the officers. Using a less lethal device, officers were successful in getting De Jesus to drop the weapon. De Jesus was later booked into Madera County Jail on multiple charges. Property crime detectives with the Fresno County Sheriff's Office have arrested 21-year-old Demetrius Williams of Fresno and 19-year-old Joseph Lepi of Fresno. Both have been booked into the Fresno County Jail on charges of robbery. Their bails are set at $280,000 each. On January 24, 2024, deputies responded to a home invasion robbery on the 8,000 block of S. Bryan Avenue near Raisin City. Two men held the victim at gunpoint and robbed him of his vehicle, cash, and cell phones. Both fled the house. The victim was not physically injured. Property detectives were assigned the case and eventually identified Demetrius Williams and Joseph Lepi as the primary suspects. Detectives obtained arrest warrants for both men. On February 27th, property crimes detectives and Ag Task Force detectives executed a search warrant at a home. Williams and Lepi were contacted and taken into custody. Detectives recovered the victim's vehicle and cell phones. All items were returned to him. Last week, a ribbon-cutting ceremony was held to honor the opening of the Fresno County Sheriff's new Area 2 substation. The facility is located on a 6.5-acre parcel of land along N. Armstrong Avenue between Belmont and E. Harvey Avenues. It features 22,700 square feet of office space and a 35,500 square foot vehicle storage building. This Area 2 substation currently serves as the headquarters for all patrol operations in the metropolitan area. The new facility is a hub for patrol briefings, community meetings, and a storage location for specialty unit vehicles and equipment that are deployed during emergency situations. The new complex replaced the former Area 2 substation located on Shields Avenue, just east of Clovis Avenue. And for more on the new station, we turn to Fresno County Supervisor Nathan Magsig.
My name is Nathan Magsig, supervisor here in Fresno County. Here with me is Austin Matalonis, who's in charge of this area for the Highway Patrol. And we're out here at the Area 2 substation. We had the ribbon cutting today, and the Sheriff's Department is very excited because this is a new building for them. But I wanted to update you just on road conditions in general, in the general area here, because many people have been reaching out to Austin as well as to my office, asking, you know, do we need to improve roads? What's causing all these accidents in Fresno County and the Central Valley in general? And I wanted to have Austin on real quick just to kind of answer these questions. So from your perspective, really, what's driving a lot of these accidents?
You know, a lot of these accidents are being driven by speed. Speed is one of the main primary collision factors we have, and it's causing these crashes to take place, and we can 100% preventable, just slow down. Slow down, stop speeding, don't look at your phones. That's one of the main causes of people being distracted, looking at their telephones or their cell phones. And then also, you know, don't drink and drive. Just don't drink and drive.
So when you think about this, speeding, distracted driving, and then driving under the influence, if we were to cut all of those out of the equation and people followed the law, I mean, you would see dramatic decreases in the people that are getting involved in accidents and losing their lives here in the Central Valley, and more specifically in Fresno County. So I'm going to be doing more on this particular topic because there are specific roads that we've seen, Minnewawa and Tulare Avenue, where there's been a number of accidents and the county's getting involved there. Millerton Road between Fryant and, of course, Aubrey Road, we've seen a number of deadly accidents there. But again, there are simple things that drivers can do. Don't drink and drive. Slow down and make sure that you're not on your devices and you're not distracted when you're driving. Those three simple things can help save a life. So Austin, I really appreciate you coming on today just to talk a little bit about this with my audience. I'll be back very soon with more updates. Please like and share this video and feel free to reach out to my office if I can help in any way. Thank you.
In other news and all new from our partners at Cal Matters, California fails to capture massive amounts of stormwater rushing off city streets and surfaces that could help supply water for millions of people a year, according to a new analysis released. The nationwide report by researchers with the Pacific Institute ranks California 9th among states with the most estimated urban runoff. Rainwater flows off streets and yards into storm drains that eventually empty into waterways and ocean, carrying pollutants picked up along the way. The analysis found that California sheds almost 2.3 million acre feet of precipitation from pavement, roofs, sidewalks, and other surfaces in city and towns every year. If it were captured and treated, that would be enough to supply more than a quarter of California's urban water use, or almost 7 million Southern California households each year. You can learn more about this at calmatters.org. Sudden death syndrome among children, a rare and devastating occurrence, affects nearly 400 families in the U.S. annually. In a breakthrough study at New York University, there's newfound hope of uncovering the cause of some of these tragic losses. Aaron Rannan from Voice of America reports.
The Began family is one of many grappling with the inexplicable loss of a child. Their daughter, Rosie, passed away at the age of 2.
Rosie was so full of life. She was just a very happy little girl. She was joking all the time. She loved being around her family.
Yeah, I mean, she was our world. Like, our entire life revolved around her.
What began as an ordinary family evening ended in tragedy with the discovery of Rosie's lifeless body early the next morning.
For some reason, I just like went into her room just to check on her, and I just noticed she was really still. When I put my hand on her back, and that's sort of when everything unraveled, I noticed that she was unresponsive, and we immediately rushed to the hospital.
Despite rushing her to the hospital, doctors couldn't determine the cause of Rosie's sudden passing.
The medical examiner contacted us, you know, within a day or two, and of course, their initial findings yielded nothing.
Amidst every parent's worst nightmare, the Began family sought answers. A clue came from a recent New York University study in which the Begans agreed to participate. researchers scrutinized bedroom camera footage of Rosie and several other children, uncovering a potential cause of their premature demise, a brief set of seizures.
All five of the continuously videoed recordings showed a convulsive event prior to the video evidence that we had where no signs of life no longer existed. We saw that the convulsions were short. They were less than a minute. That was eye-opening and shocking to everyone involved.
Laura Gould is leading this NYU research. She tragically lost her own daughter to the same medical condition at 15 months.
When a child dies, it is your worst nightmare as a parent. And so you are so incredibly vulnerable in that period. But then to be called the next day and say, we didn't find anything wrong with her. There's just not a word for it. And trying to think about living life without ever knowing put me on this path.
The seizures observed in the video camera recordings, along with the autopsy results, could contribute to a deeper understanding and potentially prevent similar tragedies.
Is there something that we can study from those autopsy specimens to identify what is different about those children? And then we can use that to understand what risk factors and identify those children at risk. And that is why these crib camera videos that we've been able to collect have been such a remarkable piece of evidence in piecing together this story.
With the increasing prevalence of video cameras in children's bedrooms, there is a glimmer of hope that the true causes of these unexplained deaths may eventually emerge. Aaron Rainin, VOA News, New York City.
And finally, in your first few minutes of Nonstop News at 8, we turn to your big stories across the U.S. and globe. Here's Democracy Now!'s Amy Goodman.
The largest wildfire in Texas history continues to grow and has spread into Oklahoma. As of Sunday, the Smokehouse Creek Fire was only 15% contained and had burned a size of land larger than the state of Rhode Island. Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas said on Sunday the blaze, which occurred amidst record heat, is a sign that the nation must be better prepared for extreme weather caused by climate change. In health news, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention has dropped its guidance that individuals who test positive for COVID-19 should isolate for 5 days. Under the new guidelines, the CDC urges people to stay home until symptoms improve and they have been fever-free for 24 hours. The new guidelines are similar to CDC recommendations for flu and other respiratory viruses.
That was Amy Goodman with Democracy Now! And that does it for your first few minutes of Nonstop News, but don't go anywhere because we have more news and weather straight ahead. New, local, unique, this is MyTV53 News at 8. Thanks for staying with us. Now to your big stories in Kern County for our viewers on KNXT. Chief Richard Stanrich from the Tehachapi Police Department explains two recent investigations resulting in multiple arrests for local retail theft.
Hi everyone, Maya Acosta, joined today by Chief Richard Stanrich to talk a little bit more about a recent search warrant that was executed in Bakersfield based on some retail theft that was done here in Tehachapi. Can you tell me more about that?
So, like with every community in California, because of the current law structure that we're under and our inability to keep the criminals in jail, we are suffering from retail theft like everybody else. But one of the things we're doing, along with our local partners in Kern County, is we are taking a zero tolerant and hard stance here. If you come to Tehachapi and steal, our investigative unit is going to do everything possible to hunt you down and put you in jail, period, bottom line. We recently had a high-level theft from Walmart where some subjects went in, stole over a couple thousand dollars worth of jewelry, Working with our local partners down in Bakersfield agencies, we were able to execute a search warrant down there, place a couple of subjects into custody, found out that the total stolen from other Walmart's targets within the Central Valley has been over 15,000. And we think that number may potentially climb as the investigation is continuing. And that's what we want to get out, is if you come to Attachpee and steal and we can hunt you down, you're going to jail, period.
Absolutely. And that ties into another recent investigation that was also kind of carried out down in Bakersfield, a years-long investigation. So continuing to drive that point home is...
Right. Yeah. We were working with Bakersfield Police Department on an investigation related to some folks that were trying to steal ATM machines, various other property from residences, be it tools or other types of goods that they could easily get out of the back of work trucks, things like that. That investigation, working with our allied partners, took over a year, culminated in, again, multiple arrests, multiple property recovered. Bakersfield is primarily handling that portion of it because the majority of the property was theirs. We did recover some property that has been returned to the rightful owners here in Tehachapi. And I can't stress enough how hard and diligent the Tehachapi Police Department Investigation Unit is working to protect the citizens at Tehachapi. We're doing our very best. And what I want to hit home today is we are here to serve and protect our public. And any information that folks have or they think that we're not getting, we are only as good as the information we can get from our public to help us continue these investigations. And I want to say at this point, it's been fantastic, but I would love for that to continue as we continue to build on our retail theft program here in the area with our local partners.
Yeah, absolutely. And any questions or concerns, anything related to crime prevention, you can email us at media at Tehachapi City Hall directly or give City Hall a call, 661-822-2200.
Or lastly, rstandridge@tehachapipd.com. And if you want to talk to me about these retail theft issues, have suggestions, comments, concerns, please reach out to my executive assistant, Ray Budge, and feel free to make an appointment and come talk to your police chief.
Awesome. Thank you, Chief Standridge, for sharing some more information on this.
Thank you.
My TV 53 News continues with the Valley's local forecast.
Welcome back. A time to put the spotlight on 559 Fights. Here's Michael Hernandez with MLH Media.
This guy came out and let the other team know that he was going to help pay for the medical bills of his opponent because he felt so bad about what had happened to him and he didn't want his career to end. That's the kind of guy that we're going to put an eye on this. You are now the Campbell State champ, the 559 Fights champ. What's the first thing you want to say?
Man, without my team, Matt Hammond in my corner. Danny Grider, he's on my team back home in Sacramento, was an MMA goal. I couldn't do it without them. I want to give a lot of credit to Isaac. He's a real warrior, real champion. Other than that, I'm ready to fight this year. I'm a hard worker. I've been doing this for a couple of years. I just kept picking it up. As soon as my coaches say I'm ready, that's when it is.
Hey, what's up, y'all? Michael Hernandez here of MLH Media, and we are here today at the Plug Stop in Sierra Vista Mall over here in Clovis, California, with my guy, Bugatti, Isaac Johnson Jr., man, the 559 Fights light heavyweight champ, brother. How you feeling?
I'm feeling good. Feeling good, ready to go.
Hey, this is kind of, I know a lot of people think, you know, you may be from the Fresno Clovis area, but you actually kind of like, you said at first, you kind of adopted, you know, you've been here for a little bit. How has it been getting over here in the Central Valley area and seeing the love that you've been getting, man?
Well, it's crazy because I'm not used to it. I'm reserved sometimes. Came out here, don't really know nobody like that except for my gym. But then, like, you know, people, I don't know if it's the energy I give them. They just, you know, they give me love. I give them love back. And that's how I've been.
Hey, I think that is a true testament to the type of person you are. You definitely have always shown love to the people that have shown you that same love back. Yeah. And I feel like even, too, when you first kind of meet people, you always are very, very jolly. You know, you're very good spirits type of person. And even it's kind of crazy to see you in that cage and to kind of hear some of your background. I feel like a lot of fight fans don't really, like, if they got to meet you at first and then they heard about you, they'd be like, what? Like, this is not a line, man. Yeah. So can you kind of give the folks a little bit of your background before you got into the fight game and before you were throwing on those 4-ounce gloves?
I'm a combat veteran. And, you know, I grew up in Sacramento, too. You know, it's you know, depending on the parts you go in there, there's some rough parts. But, you know, I'll always have to... grew up defending myself, and I like to help others. So when I joined the military, I wanted to help others that couldn't, fight back against certain people. And then it's just survival. And so I think about it, it's crazy all the time. I get goosebumps because I'm really a good person, but then I had to do some things to, I had to get out of character, you know, and that's the job I chose. My therapist said I'm addicted to adrenaline, and she's trying to say that's why I'm fighting. But I fight because, it's helping me mentally.
And a quick reminder, you can watch 559 Fights live right here on MyTV 53. Finally tonight, this week, Class 79 from Fresno Fire learned how to run with scissors. Just kidding, it was just chainsaws. They learned the critical technique of ventilation and the importance it can serve in the firefight.
This is week 8 of our academy, and this week we are running with scissors, except it's not scissors, it's chainsaws. This is ventilation week. Now you're starting to put everything together, right? They learned how to raise and throw ladders. Now they're doing that in order to bring a running chainsaw up it so that they can perform ventilation for the firefighters below. When a building is on fire, it fills with smoke. That smoke is poison. It reduces visibility and makes it more difficult for us to search for victims. But we use a tool called a rubbish hook. And it's basically a tool that we use to feel for the structural members underneath our feet. They use chainsaws and they cut a big hole in the roof, and that allows a relief.
Let's get a final look at your weather. Do expect more hit and miss showers with high in the low 60s, overnight lows around 43. The mountains will see more snow this week. Well, that does it for tonight's 8 p.m. news. I'm Valentina Saldana. Have a great rest of your evening.